Hello again. In the earlier videos, we talked about the policy documents, which are the quality policy, quality objective, quality indicators, and writing of the quality manual. I hope all those things are very clear in your minds now, so that we can move on to the next level of documents, which is the second level, which are the procedure documents. Procedure documents are basically quality system procedures and standard operating procedures. If you look at this pyramid, you will see that I have put one more component here, the work desk instructions, which are excerpts from either the quality system procedures or from the standard operating procedures. So technically they are part of the same kind of documentation, only it's a smaller abridged versions for the ease of use of the people doing the work in the front line. And these again are, we can, to recap, these are implementation documents or level 2 documents, again live documents. So recap, implementing level 2 are the procedure documents, and they are used for the implementation of the QMS that the management has established. And all these procedures talk about one specific activity per document, is one specific activity, and it becomes part of a full process. And each of the procedures will tell the technician or your frontline worker how to do a certain activity. Let's go back to the tree analogy once again to understand how these things are interrelated. Yesterday we talked about the policies flowing through the processes to become the procedures. Today let's look at the reciprocal of it also. Let's look at the procedures first. In this analogy, it is depicted as one branch or a cluster of leaves. Let's assume that is one task or one procedure, maybe a testing procedure, maybe a non-testing procedure, but it's one activity. Many activities together will flow together to become the outcome. That is, the process that you have defined has been satisfied because every procedure has been completed as per the standards requirement. And when the correct outcome that satisfies the policy the management had defined for that activity. So together, now you should hold everything together and understand the importance of defining the procedures correctly. Every procedure should be defined correctly, be it a testing or a non-testing procedure, so that every activity is done as per standard. Hence, the most important part of documentation within the laboratory are the procedures, both the quality system procedures as well as the standard operating procedures. So I hope that illustrates the importance of defining the correct steps of a procedure. And once again, to look at the difference on a table, we have already seen it in the picture. Processes are driven by the achievement of the desired outcome. We already saw the tree trunk, which is an outcome, it was a desired outcome, and the desired outcome will happen only if they are driven by the completion of the task in the correct manner. So procedures are those part of the documentation which will define the task in a stepwise correct manner. Process stages are completed by different people with the same objectives and across departments, and procedure steps are completed by different people in different departments with different objectives. To illustrate that point, think about the pre-analytical process. In the pre-analytical, there is a prescription, there is a patient preparation, there is the registration, there is collection, then there is transportation, accessioning, sample preparation. There are multiple steps, and each of these steps will be done by different sets of people, but a final outcome is one good sample with the integrity that you are looking for. So that is the outcome, whereas it involves multiple procedures. So again, to illustrate the point, processes flow to a conclusion, procedures discontinuous. All these activities that I described earlier are discontinuous procedures, and processes focus on satisfying the user, whereas procedures focus on satisfying the rules. Hence, to reiterate, the very great importance of defining your rules for procedures correctly and looking at all the evidence available to define those procedures correctly. Back to the specifics, there are two sets of procedures, quality system procedures as well as standard operating procedures, both of which can be depicted as job aids or work desk instructions. We will see in detail all these three groups of documents. First, we'll start with the quality system procedures. They are also called the mandatory procedures, or the ISO standard just describes them as procedures. These are QSPs. In this video, let's call it QSPs. QSPs do not directly involve testing. Can you think of a few procedures that within the lab which might want to be need to be written down with the details, but they do not involve testing? There are many. The standard here, in this standard, there are certain areas which define, which tell you that where this documented procedure should be written for a certain activity. For instance, 4.4 service agreement, which says the laboratory shall have documented procedures for the establishment and review of agreements. You see that phrase there, documented procedure. Go to 4.5, examination by referee laboratories. It says the laboratory shall have a documented procedure. So whenever you see that phrase, the laboratory shall have a documented procedure, it implies that the ISO thinks that it's a complex activity and require that definition of the steps included in that particular procedure. One good way to decide where to write a QSP is to go through the standard and see that, look for that phrase, the laboratory shall have a documented procedure, and write a procedure with all the steps included. And it is mandated that these are clearly documented so that each one understand his or her role. And even if it is not required by the ISO, some of the things may be complex in your laboratory that ISO probably has not mandated a procedure, but if you think it's complex enough and there are people who are not understanding all the steps of it, it is always better to write down a procedure in the as a QSP. So this is what I talked about. Whenever the ISO says laboratory shall have a documented procedure, make sure that you write it down. This is an illustrative list of some of the procedures that most of the labs write down. So you can go through this list and see there are about 18 procedures generally written down. But if you want to write more, because you want your technicians to understand the steps of it, you have to please go ahead and do that. And don't get alarmed by the large number of QSPs to be written. You can combine them. I've given some ideas about how you can combine multiple QSPs into one document. So look at this: responsibilities, authority and interrelationship, which is in 4.1, personnel and job descriptions, which is in 5.1, the organogram, all of them can be combined into one QSP. Document control under 4.3, control of records under 4.13 can be combined into one QSP. Equipment management, including selection, purchase and management of equipment under 4.6, and calibration of equipment and preventive maintenance of equipment under 5.3 can again be combined. Pre-examination, establishment of service agreements under 4.4, collection handling of samples under 5.4, storage, retention and disposal of clinical samples under 5.7, all these can be combined in the sample collection manual. So you just use your discretion and go through that standard and see what are your activities in your lab which are easy to combine. Go ahead and do that. On the contrary, if you think some process is too complex and it cannot be contained in one procedure, you can also split it. It's entirely the prerogative of the laboratory to decide how to write these QSPs. And there is again no fixed format on how to write the QSPs. In the case of the quality manual, we had looked at NABL 160 for the format. In the case of QSP, there is no fixed format. I would like to suggest a certain format. If it is acceptable to you, you can do it that way. You can write the purpose, the scope, the responsibility and the method. So in the purpose, like I'm giving an example here of the document control 4.3, you have to have a documented procedure. So what is the purpose of writing a QSP for a document control? So you can look at this line and see whether it suits your requirement. In this one, it is written to ensure that the document and the data necessary to implement the quality system are identified and controlled so that only pertinent and updated documents are available by various personnel. If that is fine, you can use that. If you want to add more to the purpose of your document control QSP, please go ahead and do that. Scope, this procedure is applicable to the following documents. Each of documents, quality manual, QSPs, SOPs, department-wise, machine-wise, activity-wise, formats and worksheets, master list, kit inserts, soft copies in the all the electronic documents, your textbooks, all these have to be brought under the document control. We'll discuss about document control later. And again, responsibility, who is responsible? So it says policy documents are prepared by the lab director or the management and the quality manager in consultation with the higher management, or directly written by the higher management. That is a better way of doing it. Quality system procedures are prepared by the lab director and the quality manager in consultation with the technical manager. So you can decide whose responsibility, the method, how are you going to do it. It need not be big, maybe like each of these QSPs may be at the most 2 or 2.5 pages long. So don't make it too complex that people will not understand. Your audience for the QSP is your frontline worker, so the language should be simple that they understand. So just write it as bullet points about what each person has to do, and that will make a good QSP. And finally, in the case of QSPs, as in the case of our quality manual, if you put a reference to other document at the end of each QSP, that will enable your documentation system to a great extent. So in this, I have illustrated, if there are second level, you are referring to other second level documents. For instance, if talking about 4.3 and 4.13 into two different QSPs, then you might want to refer to the other QSP also. So you write whichever QSP has been referred to, or maybe an SOP was referred to, or so you can write that here. And the third level document, if there are formats that you have designed here, if there are records that are external documents that you have, put all those things in whichever way suits you, so that you can, you know where to look for what document when you're talking about a QSP. So that brings us to the end of the QSPs, and we come to the most important document of the lab, which is the SOPs. And all of you have a lot of awareness about SOPs, so this will be more like a revision of what your knowledge about SOPs. And we'll go here, when we are talking about SOPs today, we are talking exclusively with reference to the ISO standard, how the ISO wants you to write your SOPs. So SOPs are required for all tests. A few things that I would like to reiterate: all tests done in the lab, including the calculated and derived parameters, provided these are standard tests, then there should be step-by-step instructions with accuracy and quality. And these are to be followed verbatim, which means that you have to write it correctly so that the technician who can take the SOP will be able to look at it and do this test as per the standards requirement. Detailed, clear and concise. The document needing to be both detailed and concise. How do we do that? We'll see that in the next slides. The SOPs have to be understood, and therefore local languages always preferred. The target audience is again your frontline worker who may not be too conversant about English, or it'll be easier for that person to understand it in the local language. So if you have a mechanism to make it happen in the local language, that is the ideal way to do it. About getting the writing your SOPs started. So we are assuming here that you are a lab who have no SOPs, and therefore that is the point that I'm going to start this discussion from. So what you have to first do is list out all the tests done in your lab and understand the procedures used, very important, and assess the scientific validity. If a test is obsolete and there is no point in writing an SOP, please don't attempt to do that. So there are many obsolete tests which are still done. So always understand the scientific validity of a test before you decide that you have to write an SOP for it. What cannot be standardized, how can you write a standard operating procedure? And then this is another crucial step. Decide on whether to write the SOPs as per activity, per equipment, or per testing procedure. So that is again your choice. Like for instance, you can have a single SOP for your biochemistry department with all the tests inside it, or you can have a SOP for each equipment. That's again a very convenient way of doing SOPs, because many of the equipments will have common steps. Your preventive maintenance will be the same, your calibration will be the same, QC protocols will be the same. So if you give a single SOP for all the common steps and then separate it out for steps which are different, that will save a lot of time. So you can think about it as writing equipment wise SOPs also. And before you get started, gather all your documents. Whatever you will need to write that SOP, make sure that you've got everything so that you don't have to run around looking for, okay, this component, I don't know what to write, let's go around. So that's a big waste of time. Make sure you put all your documents together. We'll talk about what the documents you have to gather before you get started. And include each step as per 5.5.3 of the standard. That is extremely important. 5.5.3 is your 5.5 is your examination procedures, and in 5.5 you have 5.5.3, which is your writing of your SOP. 5.5.3, documentation of examination procedures. This is the format that you have to follow while you are writing your SOP. And establish procedures for use. Very important. You have written your SOP, but nobody knows about it. It happens in a lot of labs. SOPs are locked up somewhere, or it is lying somewhere, and nobody knows where it is, or what it is for, and nobody has read it nor understood it. So it's an important thing that you establish procedures for use of SOP as soon as you make your SOP. And finally, establish the mechanisms of updating, revision and review and all that. While we are making your SOP, also go to your document control QSP and say, I'm going to review this SOP once in a year or once in 6 months. Once in a year is mandatory that you review your SOP for any BEL accreditation. Every SOP has to be looked into every year. And now we're talking about gathering all documents. What did we do by that? The documents that are required for writing your SOP will be your kit inserts, manufacturer's instructions, textbooks, other SOPs of the same methods. You can always look at it, but make sure that it is valid for your method, lab policies on quality control, lab policies on reporting, clinicians' inputs on critical alerts, and other documents, whatever you think would be relevant in writing your SOPs, make sure you have all of them with you when you are sitting down to write your SOP. Again, the one more thing that we already talked about it, this button about determining the procedure for use. You have to make sure where the location is, who is going to be the holder, verifications of use is a very good thing to do within an SOP to make sure that people have read it and understood it, and also any other thing that you would want to put into your SOP to make sure that it is used appropriately. And now the most important aspect of writing an SOP is following the ISO 15189 5.5.3, which will make your SOP detailed at the same time concise. Just follow sub clauses A to T, which is actually 20 sub points are required in an SOP. So let's examine each of these sub points one by one. Picture of the page which says ABCD, A is the purpose of examination principle, and it's up to T. So let's see each one of those sub components one by one. Subcomponent A, purpose for examination. B, principle and method for the procedure used in the examination. Purpose for examination, I'm just giving you SOP for glucose testing. Here you would write whatever the purpose, it's a pretty simple thing. It will be given in your kit insert or your manufacturer's instructions. Just look at that and write it down. It's a simple thing. There's no explanation required. Principle again will be given in your kit insert. Again, no explanation required in this case also. And your C is your performance characteristics. This is your point number C, subclause C on is your performance characteristics. And this is a concept that a lot of people are not very clear on. So what are performance characteristics? Every kit will come with, in the kit insert, the manufacturer would have defined the performance characteristics like precision, method comparison or accuracy, sensitivity, linearity. These are the certain things that are given in your kit insert, and it is frontline staff should be aware of these things. Technical supervisor, it's a responsibility of the technical supervisory staff to give those information in your SOP. So here, this is an instruction, it is a kit insert of the glucose thing, which says the CV that has been claimed by the manufacturer is 1.6% for level 1 or the low level, and for the higher level it is 1.5%. So we have to verify it in the lab, and you have to note down what your verification yielded. Again, this is your accuracy statements. Slope, intercept and correlation coefficient are three things which are required for determining the accuracy or the comparability of the method to another method, the gold standard with whatever that the manufacturer has used, and that again will be stated in the kit insert. To understand more about precision, accuracy, linearity, you're referred to look at the quality control modules which are also available on this website. It will tell you about how methods are validated. So, while writing the SOP, you need to have an understanding about what you are writing. So, I will just go back to the slide where this performance characteristics are described in this particular SOP. The linearity, the test is linearity within the concentration range of 20 to 800 that has been verified by the lab for plasma. Precision, again it has been precision verified by as repeatability is 1%, intermediate precision is for L1 is 1.5 and L2 is whatever that is, it has been written in whatever has been verified. If you look at the slide preceding, here the L1's precision they have claimed is 1.6%, the laboratory has demonstrated a 1.5%, so therefore that is acceptable. Again, method comparison. Result of the linear regression analysis R is equal to, so all these are acceptable, and so that is being noted down in the SOP. This is a little challenging at this point of time to understand the requirements of how to do these exercises. There are QC tools also that we have uploaded on the website that you can very easily do these exercises. Linearity, precision and accuracy are easily done if you follow that QC tool. All these things are explained. There is also a user manual along with this. The steps of the exercise to be done are also said in that. So, please refer to both the QC module which is there in the PDF format for you to understand, plus the QC tool. The QC tool's name is QC Soft. You may refer to that and you can follow each step of this to find out. Whenever you have a method that is coming into your lab, a new method, please make sure that this kind of a method validation is done and the performance characteristics which are claimed by the manufacturer is verified. You have to understand the details of it. So, I am not going into the details here, but try and understand these concepts. We will now go on to the subclass D, samples. In this SOP, it just describes the sample as plasma. There is no other sample being tested in this laboratory. If your glucose determination is for serum, please write serum. If it is CSF, urine are included in your testing protocols, write those as well. So, whatever sample you are using should be written here and it should be complete, the list. Whatever samples you are testing should be completely written here. And the stability, under samples you can also include very important things like how long is the sample stable for. This laboratory is saying sample stability has been validated in the lab for a period of 24 hours at 2 to 8 degrees centigrade. So, that is a protocol that is also required by NABL. And sample requirement, minimum sample volume required is 2 ml in the gray tubes containing sodium fluoride, that is also very clearly described. Sample rejection, hemolyzed inadequate sample volume, what are your rejection criteria? Frontline worker needs to know, the technician needs to know, should be described here. Subclause E is patient preparation. And then subclause F is type of container and additive. So, both are addressed here. Patient preparation, if they are specific criteria for patient preparation, describe that. It says for fasting glucose, 8 to 10 hours of fasting. Postprandial, 2 hours post meal. Random, anytime. Loading test, glucose loading test like glucose tolerance test, glucose challenge test, all those tests have got different requirements of patient preparation. So, say C along with the biological reference interval. So, the SOP is saying, I am going to describe it, but later on, look at that section. And then the type of container, blood samples should be collected in fluoride tubes. So, all these things are very clearly, should be very clearly described in your SOP. Your subclause G is your required equipment and reagents. Whatever analyzer name it is, you have to write fluoride tubes. What is the requirement of the reagent? Here it is enzymatic UV hexokinase method, it is written here. If you are talking about, if this is a since it is an automated analysis that you are talking about, there is no need to go and describe each of the steps because you really don't need to write. But if it's a semi-automated analyzer that you are writing an SOP for, you have to describe the entire testing procedure about how to do the blanking, how to do the standardization, how often to do the standardization. All those things should be written down along with your testing procedure. Reagent, again, if there is any need for preparation of the reagent, everything should be explicitly written down there. Technician, this is a one-stop place where he understands everything that is to be done in the laboratory. So everything that requires to be written down, the storage of the reagents, reagents are stable unopened up to the stated expiry and when stored at 228. Once opened, the reagents stored on board the instrument are stable for 30 days. All kinds of stability, unopened stability, open stability, everything. What are the storage requirements? Is it to be tightly capped? Can you store it on board? If it's a fully automated analyzer, do you need to take it off? If you're taking the reagent off from the board and putting it in the refrigerator, how do you put it? How do you prevent evaporation? Or if you are actually taking a reagent away from the with onboard storage facility, and how do you recap it? Very important. You cannot leave the reagents open in the refrigerator. There will be evaporation and your test will go wrong. So if that is required, please note that down in your SOP. Safety. This is subclause H is environment safety and controls. That also, whatever is required, your manufacturer generally will give you the instructions within the kit insert. If it is not available, you please ask for it. And if there are certain reagents, will require additional MSDS sheets. Hope you know about MSDS. MSDS is a material safety data sheet. Some reagents may require additional MSDS sheets to be included in the SOP or at least filed separately. Make it a point that you look at every reagent's safety requirement and put it in the key points should be written in your SOP. Whatever instructions are available should be filed separately for any kind of reference. Next is your calibration procedures or metrological traceability. Calibration is again an area where it should be very correctly defined, and just don't write one line there and finish it off. It is extremely important that you include these vital steps. What is the calibrator required? What is the frequency of calibration? How do you prepare the calibrator? What is the stability of the calibrator? And what is the traceability? Minimum 5 points under calibrations. Please look at this correctly, clearly, and understand. In the case of if you are using plasma, CSF and urine, you may have different calibrators. CSF microprotein, certain amount of, when the amount of glucose detected is minimal, there could be other calibrators there. So you have to look at the requirement of the calibrators, and you have to underline, you have to tell your technician which calibrator should be used for what kind of sample. And then frequency of calibration, you can either follow the manufacturer's instruction or make your own protocol. It's ideal always to make your own protocol because your calibration may not be valid as per your manufacturer's instruction. So may define your own protocol. Again, one point which I'd like to tell you here is that certain tests, we are now talking about glucose analysis, which is a quantitative test. SOPs need to be written for qualitative tests also. So these things may not be required in those things. If it is not required, you can just write NA, not applicable. Like your performance characteristics, like precision, accuracy, linearity are not possible in the case of determined in the case of qualitative test. So you can write NA, or if you have certain sensitivity, specificity specifications there, you can include that. So calibration may not be important, may not be applicable to some tests. You can write it accordingly. And coming back to the calibration, the preparation of the calibrator is very important. How do you do it? The details should be written. Extremely important that the details should be written down of the calibrator preparation. Traceability of the calibrator will be given in your calibrator insert. Look at it and just write what is the traceability. Again, a very important concept. Please look at the equipment management module to understand more about traceability. These things should be defined correctly in your SOP. So after calibration comes your testing procedure. So you can, this is where you need to write down, it's not in, along with the equipment, you can write it there also, but here testing procedure, whatever the analyzer guide is there, you have to write it down. Everything would be written clearly for the operator to do the testing correctly. The next is subclause K, quality control. Under the quality controls, you have to define what are the internal quality control procedures and what are the external quality assurance procedures, how to do both. Majority of the labs make another SOP exclusively for quality controls, which is actually a very good idea, in which you can describe the details of your internal quality control program and your external quality control programs, about how to reconstitute your QCs, be it external QCs or internal QCs, and how do you run it, and what is your periodicity for review, whether what are the rules which the frontline staff will look at, what are the rules the supervisory team will look at. So all those things can be very clearly defined if it's a separate SOP. However, if you want to put it inside the same SOP, you can do it. Or as we said earlier, this calibration, QC and all are common, the process of reconstitution and all is, it's a common for an equipment. So you can write it equipment wise in under one heading in the same SOP for the equipment. And coming to the interferences and limitation, again specific to each reagent, it will again be given in the kit insert, and please make sure that you write it down, because if you have in this case for the glucose, there are four interferences. Generally the interferences are LIH, lipemia, icterus and hemolysis, plus ascorbate also is listed in this. So they give you the cutoffs for all these kinds of interferences, so the technician will again know you have a very high bilirubin sample and you are not able to analyze the glucose because of whatever interference. So the technician can go back and look at your SOP and see how much of interference is that bilirubin causing on your sample. So this is your subclause. Next L, and then you have the subclause M, calculating the results to include measurement uncertainty. This is a concept again that needs to be understood. More about measurement uncertainty will be talked about in the videos on quality controls, and please look under that. Measurement uncertainty is defining the amount of uncertainty your values or your report has, and it is not mandatory that you put it on the report, but if somebody is asking you, your clinician is asking you, what is uncertainty of your measurement, suppose you have given the glucose value of 90 and this is a patient with gestational, pregnant patient, and if your uncertainty is 5, it could be 95, that could be a impaired fasting glucose for a diabetic, for a pregnant patient. So at the certain points your clinicians may ask you, what is your uncertainty of measurement? If that is asked, you should have a number to give them, so that you have to specify in your SOP, what is your uncertainty of measurement. And if you don't want to specify it has in the SOP, it should be available somewhere in the lab. Like for instance, in this SOP it is written, the uncertainty of measurement is calculated using the coverage factor of 2 as per NABL recommendation on a 6-monthly CV at both L1 and L2 levels of the QC. This data is available in the lab and is reviewed every 6 months. This will be made available to the clinician on request. If you write that much, that will be enough, but it should be available in the lab, because you are going to review it every 6 months. It may not be feasible to write the number down in your SOP, because every time that number changes, you can't keep on amending your SOP or reviewing your SOP. So you can hold it separately, but what is your process should be written down in your SOP. This, for more about this, this requires more understanding the concept of uncertainty measurement. Please refer to the QC videos. Biological test intervals is your next subclause N. So here it says plasma, fasting, adults, and whatever that the role is, what the biological reference interval is, and children. If you have got more intervals to define, please, or every interval that requires definition should be defined. In the case of hematology, where there are multiple biological reference intervals for newborns, infants and children, so make sure that everything is clearly defined. Even in the case of glucose, there will be multiple reference ranges. So let's see how the SOP is written here. So it is, they have written for oral glucose tolerance test, what is the interpretation for, what is the value interpretation, all these things are clearly written. You can read and understand whichever guideline you are following. So here it says it is as per the ADA norms. you have to make sure that you write down what are the guidelines that you are using to define these biological reference ranges. Again, one more interpretation is a criteria for the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus, again as per ADA. So whatever is required to be put into the SOP, because you have already in while you were talking about patient preparation, if you remember that you talking about the loading in the section of biological reference ranges. So, the 75 gram glucose, these things are written down in along with your biological reference ranges. So, somewhere in the SOP it should be very clearly mentioned what is a load that you would give and what should be the reference range for a certain load. So, for instance, sample drawn at 1 hour after a 50 gram glucose load. So, and for that there is a 1 hour value with interpretation. So, this can be given in whichever way you would want to give, but it should be there in the SOP. And reportable range is one more concept that we have to understand. Here it says 10 to 1600. Should have been 20 to 1600 because the lower limit of linearity demonstrated was 20 and the upper limit of linearity demonstrated was 20 to 800. So, this please correct this. This is 1600 mg per dL. So how do you report 1600 for when you can measure only 800? That is the instruction determining the results when the result is not within the measurable range, that is your subclause P. How do you manage to do that is a question that you have to ask. So, because there every equipment has a linearity which is defined. So, in this case, whatever the definition was, the laboratory has verified it up from 20 to 800. So, now the laboratory has to instruct its frontline worker, its technicians, for samples with concentration less than 20 mg per dL, the result should be reported as less than 20 mg per dL. No number will be there, it will be just the less than sign and 20 mg per dL. For samples with concentration more than 800, the plasma should be diluted 1:1 and multiplied by 2. So, that is how you have put the reportable range. And how do you assign a reportable range is another question that you have to ask. It depends upon, again it is your laboratory's prerogative. Suppose you do not want to report more than 800, you can always say more than 800. Like saying less than 20, you can say more than 800. If that is good enough for your lab, then it is fine. If it is not and you need to give a number, up until what level? You have to make some sensible judgment there from your experience. There are papers available to the reportable range. So, you can fix your upper limit, how much, however much you will report, you can instruct your technician that you do this many dilutions. In this case, the laboratory says my machine is capable of finding out up to 800, but I would like to report up to 1600. Therefore, my technician is required to dilute it one time and then multiply it by 2 to give you and give that in the report. So, you decide. So, like for instance, in the case of a hemoglobin, most of the equipments will have a very good linearity up to 25. You may not need to dilute anything. So, you can just write your reportable ranges whatever to 25, maybe 2 to 25 and that you do not need to report more than that. It may not even be happening. But in the case of a total count, if your linearity is only up to 100,000 or 1 lakh and you may have leukemic cases which with much more higher readings than that. So, there you need dilution. Your technician should be told which samples for what parameters there should be dilution and how do you even understand that the linearity has been breached. So, that is something which you need to understand about your equipment. Every equipment have got mechanisms of flagging when the linearity is breached. That has to be understood by the technical team on what are the flags and how will you look at a sample. Maybe there is an exclamation mark, maybe there is an asterisk, some kind of a number, maybe a number or maybe a alphabet or something will be near that reading to indicate that this has breached the linearity and the laboratory should decide how to proceed. And when the technician, that also should be told to the technician, this is your indication that the linearity has been breached and therefore, you need to instruct the technician when you see this flag, you have to do this dilution. So, that will give the technician the complete instruction of how to proceed. That is about your subclause P. Now, to subclause Q, panic alerts. Panic values are those values which can affect the patient's safety if you don't report it immediately. It will be either extremely high values, low values, and to get a guidance on these things, you can the ideal way to define a panic value is to check with your clinician. What is the panic alert that your clinician wants to be reported? So in this one, they have said ki low is they have said that the low is 40 and the high is 450 for adult. For children, this way, newborn, these are the lower limits and these are the lower and the higher limits. So again, it is the discretion of the lab, but in consultation with the clinician, because some clinicians may not want it. Like you have a nephrology unit and patients on dialysis, and what every patient may be having a high urea creatinine. So what you would want to call a panic value for a normal patient may not be a panic value for a patient who is already on dialysis. So you don't need to call that the doctor every time to say this is breach the panic levels, I'm calling you. So this need not be done. So therefore, you have to define it with the requirement of your clinicians, and guidance towards this can be received from Teeth's textbook of biochemistry. It gives you a very good list of panic values. Just that's something that you can start with, and then you can consensus building with the clinicians. R is interpretation. Interpretation is that everybody will already know about what are the interpretations when you, since we are talking about glucose, what are the way things that you need to understand about glucose estimation, not going into the details. Then potential sources of variation. So again, what are the pre-analytical variables? There are variations, even intra-individual variations are there, inter-individual variations are there, but that is acceptable variation. What are the variations which is beyond that? If that is present in an, it is a part of one analyte that there are variations that can happen, you need to write it down. Like for in glucose, your food intake is something which will make it a variable. So you need to write down what are the important things. Additionally, if there are other things that here it is written, the quickness of separation of the red cells from the plasma by centrifuge, it is a critical element. So whatever the technician should, you feel should be knowing, just write it down. And finally, the references are to be there in any kind of a document. So in the case of SOPs also, the reference here, the text is referring to the Teeth's textbook of chemistry, XYZ chemistry analyzer manual, ADA guidelines. So whatever you have used in the writing of your SOP, please write it down. Additionally, if you want to refer to your lower level documents, like in the case of QSP, that again is a thing that you can do, though the standard does not ask for it, but it will allow you to trace your, if it is important, because for all the equipment, there will be so many references, I mean, lower level documents in terms of formats and records. So you can actually put it at the end of the entire equipment SOP also, that you know what are the formats that you are holding to make this whatever is said in this SOP. Like there will be a panic alert format, there will be a format for calibration, there will be a QC format. So all those things you can list it out somewhere in the SOP so that it becomes easier for you to look and what are the supporting documents that is this SOP has. After SOP, we'll go into the job aids or work aids that we have been talking about. And it can be either for QSP or SOP. These are shortened versions of an SOP that can be posted at the work site as a reminder of the steps to be completed. Supplements, and it does not replace the QSP or SOP. It is only a supplementation. It is to be placed in a visible location. Should include the same information as the SOP and QSP, but not all the information. Some of the information, which for quick reference, you will put it up somewhere where it is visible and which the technician can use it as a ready reckoner. The job aids are required to be under the document control, and that's important. All job aids are under document control, and they may be flow charts, pictorial forms, whatever that is. And we'll just look at a few job aids which are very useful and generally used also. Hand hygiene, you have to have a document control element. Where will you put this lab hand hygiene? Where do you think reference to the SOP for this will be, would have been in your laboratory safety manual? In your 5.2, there is a accommodation environment safety. You can write wherever you want, or when you're talking about your personnel, or that when any of these places where you're referring to your infection control mechanisms, laboratory safety manual is one of the quality system procedures that you make. With it's a different, little different from the QSPs, but it has to be there in every lab about safety. When you're talking about infection control and biosafety, you will refer to hand hygiene, and with reference to that, you may have a workbench instruction or a job aid. Where would you place this job aid? You would want to place it where your hand washing happens, maybe near your sink. That is where you will put this job aid. It's a very important job aid. Then you want to look at a pre-analytical during sample collection. What is your order of draw? It's a very important job aid at your collection point. Accessioning point, this is a very important job aid at your accessioning point, like what degree of hemolysis will you reject. This is like a color chart, and the technician can very easily, the person at the accessioning can very easily look at the color chart and say, I'm beyond this, I'm rejecting. So this is another job aid that can be given at accessioning. And sample transport, I'm following the sample path in this job aid descriptions. Sample transport, so if you have got a certain packing system, you keep the cool pack at the bottom, then you put the refrigerated specimens here, you put the ambient temperature specimens there, and then there will be towels in between. So it becomes a very easy thing for your courier people to understand how to pack samples. Then this is an analytical job aid that you might want to put where your microscopy happens in clinical pathology, some ideas about what are your crystals and all that. And this is a microbiology thing for inserting the loop into the urine to ensure that the proper amount. This is another job aid that can help. Streaking of the plate, this is another job aid. These are all during the analytical, pre-analytical cycle. This is a QC job aid that can be put up to understand what are your rules for rejection if you are ruling multi-rules. Then post-analytical, of course, you have to have critical alert tables. Wherever your critical alert table should be there at multiple points. It should be there at near your equipment, because as soon as your technician sees a very high or a very low value, they'll immediately report. So wherever analysis happens, make the critical alert tables available at different points as job aids. And sample retention protocols should be available. Sample storage fridge, how long will you store each kind of sample, that should be available. And biomedical waste disposal protocols can be put up at your point wherever you would segregate your samples for disposal. So these are important job aids to be displayed. So we have come to the end of the level 2 document and documents, and once again to recap how the procedures are extremely important, the most important I would say part of your laboratory, should define each task clearly, concisely and in detail, and every clause of the standard should be addressed as per the standard. It will become extremely easy that you will not miss any point if you actually follow the standard. Every aspect will be covered, and each, whether some of them are QSP, some of them are SOPs, all these should be defined correctly. And if it is defined correctly, and then like we said initially, it has to be followed verbatim by the technicians. And if that happens, your outcome is what you are looking for, which is going to satisfy your policy. So this is how your second level of documents work. Your policies will be satisfied only if your procedures are written correctly and followed correctly. Therefore, your processes satisfy your policies. Thank you.